Now, this morning, we are glad to have Reverend Pope back with us this morning. He needs no introduction. He was here for our homecoming that wasn't homecoming. But we're glad to have you, Brother Pope, if you'd come and lead us as the Lord sees fit.
Was that the trumpet?
It wouldn't be a perfect Sunday without some kind of audio problem, correct? It's going to happen. And you know, most preachers don't need any help to be heard, but for recording purposes, if somebody else on the planet can turn us off, we do this for their benefit. Well, anyway, it's good to be back with you good folks at the Black Creek Baptist Church. And a couple of weeks ago, I was just up the road at the Great Swamp Baptist Church, filling in for them, and hopefully to be back a part of their journey. And for many of you, as we get a chance to speak before or after the service, you're not really sure what to call me, because the first time I came, I was asked if I was a doctor, and I said, no, I'm not even a good patient, so don't call me doctor. My whole ministry, during probably the first 20 years, I was simply known as Brother James, and then when we went to Maryland, it became Pastor James. It doesn't matter whatever you want to call me, just make yourself comfortable. Glad to be friends, and glad to know you folks, and glad to be a part of your story and your journey. And I do know this, if you have a sense of humor, we're going to get along very well. And if you don't, just pray for us, and we'll pray for you that God inspires you to be able to learn to laugh. Life is much better when you can learn to laugh about the stuff that's challenging to deal with. As I told you last time we came, you know, I go online and I watch the preaching and the preachers that you've had to fill in your time without a pastor. And I don't know the motivations, I don't know the thoughts, I don't know the processes that those men go through in preparation, but for me, because of my calling in this season of my life, to come alongside and have a word for a church where that church is in their life cycle. And you're a church that is currently without a shepherd, I think that's safe to say. And you're wondering, you know, where the next person is going to come from, when they're going to come, and those kind of things. And for that reason, all of my preparation and thought is geared to help speak to those issues for you as a church. It would be real easy to simply come and do something you enjoy and like, and it would be easy for me and go our sweet way and part as friends, but that's not what I'm called to do. Nor am I called to tell you what you want to hear. Trust me, I had a young man leave a church service a few years back, and I don't remember what the issue was about, but it didn't sit well with him, and on the way out he stopped and he said, Pastor, he said, I thought your job was to make us feel better. And I said to him, well, nobody gave me that memo. That's not my job. My job is to tell you the truth. If you have a problem with the truth, then you need to take it up with the person who dispenses that truth, which is the Lord. So for that reason, I want to do something. Of course, as many times as I get invited to come back, the fact that the first time was a blind date, apparently it went well enough to get invited to come back, was invited for next Sunday, but we had prior obligations to go back to Texas and see family there that are struggling. What I want to be able to do is I want to be able to, for you as a church and our time together today, to tie in this season of the year and what you just read about and what you just sang about with what's going on in the life of your church right now and your hope and your expectations and your prayer for a new pastor when they come. And I know some of you are going, well, I want to see how he does that, tying those two things together. So I want to set the message up. I want to show you a brief video clip that I'm pretty sure most of you are going to appreciate and enjoy. And at least some of you say, well, the first 3 minutes of the sermon were pretty good. The rest of it, we just sort of let it slide. So watch this, and we'll make a point, and hopefully our technology serves us well.
Boy, you've had this a long time.
Well, since the eighth grade. And you want to know something? There's things right there in that book that I learned that I still remember to this day.
Oh, come on.
To this day. It's amazing how that stuff stays with you. Once you learn something, it never leaves you. It just stays locked up tight right in the old noodle.
Does, huh?
Sure. Here, let me show you. There, Constitution of the United States. Now, we had to memorize the preamble of that. Mm. I still remember it.
You do?
Yeah. Here, I'll show you. Hold the book on me.
Okay. All right, go ahead.
Constitution of the United States. Well, give me the first word, and then I'll know the rest.
Okay, we.
We.
We?
We. Are you sure?
I'm looking right at you.
Oh, we. We!
The.
The. We the. We the.
People.
We the people. We the people. We the people. We the people.
The United.
We the people of the United flag. Breathe. Wind. Wave. Star.
States.
States. We the people of the United States.
In order.
In order.
To form a.
To form a.
More perfect.
Perfect.
You.
To form a more perfect you.
Union.
Union. In order to form a more perfect union.
S.
S.
Ta.
Ta.
Ble.
Ble.
Shh.
Establish.
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 Just.
Establish just.
Test.
Test. Justice. Establish justice.
Ensure domestic tranquility. Provide for the common defense. Promote the general welfare. And secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity to ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. You want to run through that again, or do you think you got it?
I got it. You learn something, you learn it.
Now, preacher, what are you going to do with that? To tie this season together with the life cycle of this church. Well, actually, I started out, I came on that clip because I was thinking about, for whatever reason, I just want to think it's the spirit, the introduction, the preamble to the Constitution. Because there's something that was stated in there, and when I remembered it, I remembered this scene from the Andy Griffith Show. Now, trust me, I'm probably the only preacher you'll ever have who has a t-shirt with Barney Fife on that says, "Nip it in the bud." And everywhere I go, I'm everybody's friend because everybody loves Barney. I'm the only preacher who actually has a copy of the Barney Fife driver's license that I carry in my wallet. In case I get stopped by the law enforcement, I can give it to them. I thought about that, and because I know that you'll remember at least this part of the service. You see, Barney had a problem with his memory, and sometimes memory can serve us well, and sometimes it doesn't serve us so well. And I think the older we get, the less it serves us well. Do you get amen to that? Yeah. You remember, you may not remember so well, and if you're married, you probably won't remember correctly, but you will remember. And that's a part of the journey and the challenge for a church and for you as a church in this season. But it was this expression in the preamble of the Constitution that sort of struck this note on the passages that we're going to be looking at today, where we the people, in order to do what, Barney? To form a more perfect union. I hadn't thought about it before, but it struck me as I remembered those words, and I went back and provided this video clip for you so you'll remember those words, is that when our country was founded, And you well know that the history of this church goes almost back that far. 200 years in 2007, I saw it on the plaque coming in outside. Now, thank goodness you weren't in this building, or you're not in the same building they were in back then. I've gone back and read the history of the Black Creek Baptist Church. That when this nation was formed, there was a union already. There were 13 colonies in existence. These were British colonies that had come over a span of time, up and down the eastern seaboard, and had set up these colonies where people were discovering life here that was decidedly different. But they got a little taste of freedom while they were here, out from underneath the oppression of the British rule. And when they came together, you know, opposing taxation, we know that story, and they decided it was time to launch and create what, not 13 colonies, but what, 13 states. Their statement was, in order to form a what, more perfect union. They saw that what they had had worked. It had served a life, and it had served a lifetime for them. But they saw in that moment, because they tasted something that they wanted more of, that they decided it was time to become independent from the British government and British control, to form a what, more perfect union. It's for that reason that we're entitling today's message is the Becoming Church. Because those original colonists, of which South Carolina plays a big role in the history, Francis Marion had much to do with the American Revolution here that I've learned about in the last year. Read his biography and been in some of those areas, those swamps that he worked through as a part of doing this, that realizing that the church of the New Testament and the church that was birthed in the book of Acts was birthed to be a becoming church. And just as those original colonists thought they needed what, in order to form a more perfect union than what they had, did what they did. And so the question that we're going to attempt to answer today is not whether you are a becoming church, but if you want to become a becoming church. I don't guess that's a duplicity, is it? Do you want to be a becoming church? So we're going to read a couple of passages today. The first of these, we're going to speak to these three issues. First, becoming as a what? Becoming as a biblical principle. Because I think every one of you would agree that before everything else, in the middle of everything else, and after everything else, everything has to be tied, what? To Scripture. And if you can't support it here, do you need to be doing it? It doesn't mean that it is wrong, it just means it's without biblical foundation. So the whole concept of becoming is, in fact, that a biblical principle. Look at John chapter 1, a couple of verses here. We're going to read all of it, out of respect to time. And most of you, many of you, probably have these words memorized because it's a part of your spiritual journey. This is actually the Apostle John's version of the Nativity. you have the ones that are popular and famous in Matthew and Luke. Mark just completely skips it altogether. But this is John's version of those events. He said, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word, what? Was God. And then in verse 14, the writer of John says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we saw His glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. This is John's nativity account. In the beginning was the Word. This is the beginning of everything. In the beginning was the Word. Who was the Word? The Word was Jesus before He was born. He was with the Father and He was the Father. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God and the Word was God. And then after He goes through all the other information, He comes down to synthesize the events that you will be celebrating and much of the world will be celebrating in another week. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we saw His glory, the glory of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. You see, becoming as a biblical principle finds at least its expression here, if not its foundation here. The becoming that's a biblical principle is that who became what in this scenario? God, in the form of Jesus, became man in order that what? We might encounter God through Him. Is that a pretty safe statement? God in the person of Jesus became a man, became flesh, in order that we might know God and encounter God through Him. Is that not what the Christmas account is all about? It's not just about, although many want to make it, a baby in a manger. As a matter of fact, I got to thinking about this just last night in preparation. I would like to see somewhere, somebody set up a scene with a line of children to get their picture taken of a manger with little kids going and standing next to a manger and having their picture taken with a manger in the celebration of the birth of Jesus. Would y'all like that? I think that'd be awesome. because that would be more in keeping with what the account is about. So in terms of the question, is becoming a biblical principle, the truth of the matter is, this is the word that theologians use to describe the event of Jesus becoming flesh. God before, God the Word, becoming flesh in human form. It's the word incarnation. And the word incarnation just simply means, it's made up of Greek words, it simply means what? In the flesh. God came in the flesh. I was glad that the brother read the passage out of Matthew that cites Isaiah, where it talks about when Jesus would come, what would he be called? He would be called Emmanuel, which is God with us. God with us is the concept of incarnation. Now, you can spiritualize that and say, well, listen, God is with us all the time because God can't help, because God is everywhere. God is with us. Now, when the prophet talked about Emmanuel, he wasn't talking about spiritualization of the presence of God in a person's life. He was talking about the realization of the presence of God in a person's life, in the person, in the form of Jesus Christ. And it is called incarnation. That is the whole principle of becoming. He didn't have to, but he chose to, that God in Jesus became flesh in order that we might know him and encounter him. Frankly, that's what we ought to be celebrating this time of the year, is the fact that God did something for us that we couldn't do for ourselves. And so to step back and look at the scripture, we've got Barney not being able to remember the preamble, stating the fact that those original colonists felt that what they had worked up to that point, but they needed something better in order to what? Form a more perfect union. The Old Testament system had worked. It had served its purpose and its time. Now, we tend to think of the Big Ten when you think about the Old Testament law, the thou shalt nots, but we know that what God gave to Moses out on Mount Sinai was more than just 10 words. There were over 600 laws that covered every aspect of life. From life at home, to life on the farm, to raising animals, to the clothing that you wore, to the food that you ate, right down to what? The religious practices of the temple and sacrifice. Those served a purpose in their place and in their time, and yet when that time had been served, there was a more perfect union being created, and that was when God, what? Became something that he didn't have to, that we can become something that we would not be otherwise. Becoming is a sound biblical principle. The Old Testament system served its purpose in its time. And if you look at Paul's writing, he said that was to point us to Jesus and tell us that we can't do it without him. The becoming is the foundation of the cornerstone then of the New Testament. So becoming as a biblical principle, the answer is yes, in the form of incarnation. Then there's becoming in Scripture as a personal principle. As a personal principle. Now, this passage out of 1 Corinthians chapter 9, this passage became one of several that about 20 years into ministry for me, so this makes it almost 30 years ago, when I understood what Paul writes here in a decidedly different way that affected me and influenced my life and my ministry, and I bring that to you. So listen as we look at these words from the Apostle Paul about becoming. As a personal principle. He says in verse 19, "For though I am free from all men, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I may win more. To the Jews, I became as a Jew, so that I might win Jews. To those who are under the law, as under the law, though not being myself under the law, so that I might win those who are under the law. To those who are without law, as without law, though not being without the law of God, but under the law of Christ, so that I might win those who are without law." Before we look at the next slide, look at how many times the Apostle Paul talks about this concept of becoming as a personal principle in his life. He says, "Though I'm free, I have made myself." That's a becoming principle. Something that I was not, something that I have not been. He said, "I've made myself to this purpose, so that I might win more." What kind of winning is he talking about here? Is he talking about a race? Is he talking about a competition? No, he's talking about souls. He's talking about people's lives. He's talking about those that don't know God in Jesus Christ. He did all this that he might engage them more. To the Jews, he became, there's the word. To the Jews, I became a Jew. What? To win the Jew. To those under the law, I became under the law. Those without law, I became as without law, although not the law of God, because I had the law of Christ, so that I might win those who are without law. To the weak, I became weak, that I might win the weak. I become all things to all men, so that I may by all means save some. I do all things for the sake of the gospel, so that I may become a fellow partaker of it. Do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way as to win. I'll leave it to you. Go back and look at this text and answer the question. How many times in this one brief passage, verses 19 through 24, does Paul talk about this principle, this personal principle of becoming in his life? He said, this is who I am. I know Christ by the grace of God. Acts chapter 9. Go back and read the story. I didn't want to believe in him. I didn't want to acknowledge him. I had an encounter. I had a collision with him. He called me into a faith relationship. He saved me. He forgave me. Called me into ministry. Sent me on this missionary journey. He said, that's what I've been doing. And he said, and I've become something I was not before, not just because I had an encounter with a person who became flesh for my sake, but he said, when I look at the world around me, and we know the story of Paul, don't we? When he was Saul, he was the Jew's Jew. He was a Pharisee. He was a teacher. He was a leader. He was a point man. He hated Christians. He had a high-profile place in life. He was successful in what he did. He was multilingual. He was well-traveled and well-spoken and well-written and well-read. And in his mind, the Messiah had been a Jewish Messiah. And the church, when it was born, was a Jewish church. But God did something in his journey that the concept of becoming took root in his heart in terms of his role and his responsibility to those around him. He realized that Jesus wasn't just a Jewish Messiah, that Jesus died, that anyone, anywhere, regardless of their background or their nationality or their race, could know God in the person of Jesus Christ. And he said, I realize that the people that I encounter in my missionary journey, whether it's church planting or whether it's on the road or I happen to be locked up with somebody in jail, I realize that they don't have my life. They don't know my life. They didn't come where I came from. They didn't do what I did. They don't know what I know. They have a void in their hearts and in their eyes that they have sin that they're going to pay for if something doesn't take care of that. And the question is, how do I build the bridge to them that I might share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them? He says, now I know when it comes to my Jewish brethren, he said, I would ask myself to be accursed that they all might come to faith. He said, so to them, I need to come across as the most Jewish person they know, so they'll give me a hearing when I talk about Jesus. But he said, when they're not Jewish, when they're a Gentile, they weren't raised in a Jewish home. They don't know what a kosher pickle is. They don't know any of those things. I have to speak a language they understand. I have to communicate in ideas and words and concepts that they understand. He said to those that are without law and those that are, he said, I'm the one who is responsible for what? For the becoming principle in my life in order they might know. And to do so that I might what? Win the more. And I do all this for the sake of the gospel. And that I love the fact that he concludes this by saying, listen, we all understand the concept of running races. He says, but when you run a race, it doesn't matter how many contestants there are. He said, there's only one winner. And I don't know who said it. I've quoted him more few than a few times, and not everyone is entertained by this statement as I am. But what is said about the second place finisher? The second place finisher is what? The first loser. Yeah, Todd got it. Paul says, listen, nobody wants to be the loser. He said, if you're going to do what God has called you to do in terms of sharing the gospel, being salt and light and touching the people in your lives, because you shouldn't be living in these bubbles that the only people you come in contact with are people that are like you. He said, when you come in contact with people that are not like you, how do you become? What do you become in order that you might gain a hearing, which is the best that you can do, to share the gospel with them. He says, my goal is, he said, I don't like being the first loser. So he said, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to play to win. I think it's safe to say that Paul could be credited with also the other expression is that winning isn't everything. Winning is the only thing. He said, so run as a believer. He said, do what you do as an engaging person in life and culture with people that are unlike you, that need Jesus. You become the becomer to them in order that you might gain a hearing and share the gospel with them. So a little personal journey. I'm going to show you some pictures because we don't think in words, we think in images. To help you understand this personal journey for me and understanding that becoming process for Paul as a believer and for me as a believer as well. This is a picture standing out in front of the church where I got saved. My dad was a pastor. I'm the one in the snappy burgundy little jacket there with a nice crew cut. I was 6 years old when I gave my heart to Jesus. I was born into a family and in the culture into a time when being a Christian was sort of permeated into the life of the culture that we knew. Those of you that are much, well, at least a little bit older than I am, you know this very well. That the world of the 50s in the United States, that if you were to succeed in life, you had to be somehow connected with a church or religious organization. Because if you were not, you were suspect. Because it was assumed that you believed in God and hopefully you believed in Jesus. That permeated our culture, even though it wasn't written anywhere. And our Constitution, you know, forbade that kind of interaction. That was a part of life. So this is the world that I was born into and I was saved in and became a part of as a part of church life. In this whole business because it was hard at times to distinguish who the believers from the non-believers were. At the age of 20 is when God called me to preach. This is not quite 50 years ago, but this is pretty close to 50 years ago when God called me to preach. And the only thing that I knew about being a believer is I'd been sharing the gospel with my friends, with schoolmates. I'd seen people come to the Lord. And I didn't understand that concept of becoming because we all lived in a very similar kind of world and sort of a safe world. Now, at this point in time, it was the 70s, and the 70s life had changed in the United States from the 50s. And so I was a part of that environment where my classmates and the people I went to school with, they had, you know, they'd left the church and they'd left family and spirituality and done other things. But I still saw myself in isolation. I had the truth of the gospel, and I wanted to share the truth of the gospel, but I didn't yet quite understand that notion of becoming. I knew that when I was called to preach that I would do this. I would stand and I'd proclaim the gospel, and people would come, and they'd get to hear the word and perhaps walk the aisle or have a chance in a car or a home somewhere to share the gospel for them to respond to it. And so I didn't quite understand Paul's notion of becoming as a believer as a personal principle. And so I did ministry. This is a picture of the first church that I pastored in the middle of nowhere, the Victory Baptist Church. When I pastored, they didn't have that nice awning out on the side that you could drive under. Our first Sunday there were 16 people present for worship. And by the end of the year, there were 60 people in worship. But it was the only game in town. This is where the Methodists came and the Baptists came and the Presbyterian came because there weren't any other churches around. So if people wanted to do church, they showed up at the Baptist church. And so I got to share, you know, preach to a number of different people. But again, it was a decidedly different world back then that you understand the concept of homogeneity where there's like people. They have similar backgrounds and similar lifestyles and similar values and in a similar culture and a similar setting. That's the kind of place that I began to preach. This is the only picture that was taken inside, and there's my beloved wife sitting at the piano that was way out of tune. I would preach, and she'd play the piano. And this is an image of us when we were both young and skinny. She's still skinny, I'm not. But anyway, this is a journey for me, is I'm still not wrapping my mind around Paul's personal principle of becoming. You know, I'm sharing the gospel. I'm the preacher. I'm the pastor, even though we were commuting from college back then. I still didn't understand the implications of Paul's becoming principal at this point in time. Now, all these years later, fast forward, skip a lot of years and a lot of pictures. Because I'm committed to share the gospel with people who need Jesus. I know that you and I live in a world where most of the people we encounter outside these walls do not know Jesus. Is that safe to say? Most of them don't know Jesus, and they're not really interested in hearing about Jesus. Would that be safe to say? And so when I build relationships and connect with those people outside of my formal function as a preacher or as a pastor or whatever I'm doing as a consultant, the question is, how do I connect with them with Paul's principle of becoming? Do I show them picture? Hey, so let me show you what I do. I don't think a mechanic, you know, with grease up to his elbows is interested whether I wore a suit and stand before a crowd of people and preach. I understood in the last 30 years, I went from accepting the fact or assuming the fact that people would give me a hearing to accepting the fact that nobody owed me a hearing outside of the walls of the church. As a matter of fact, I don't even think you owe me a hearing because I'm here. I feel I have to earn the right to be heard. One of the ways that I do that, I show silly video clips that you'll remember me for one reason or another. It opens. So how have I done this? If I'm trying to relate to somebody that doesn't know God, doesn't know Jesus, perhaps has never been to church in their lives, am I going to talk about the fact that I'm a preacher, or am I going to say, hey, listen, I ride a motorcycle? There are people out there that I will encounter and go, oh, well, that's really cool. What kind of motorcycle? Well, of course, they say, Harley? No, thank you. It's not a Harley. Or let's go a step further. Oh. Yeah, that's it. Because I've ridden a motorcycle longer than I've been married. I've been married for 45 years, been preaching for 47, been riding motorcycles longer than that. The Lord has opened doors of building relationships with people in order to share the gospel. That picture of me in the blue tank top there, sweating. I don't look like a biker. I've never looked like a biker. Standing to my left is one of the officers of the local chapter of the Hell's Angels in Maryland. The church that I pastor, we'd do an annual bike day, and all the local clubs would come out, and we'd have hundreds of bikes come out as part of this. And the Hell's Angels, we invited them, and they came out and set up a tent, and we mingled with them so that we can share the gospel with them. I got a chance to go to John Hopkins Hospital and pray with one of the members of the Hell's Angels chapter who had been in an automobile accident and was needing somebody to pray for him. You see, the fact that I wore a suit and preached in a big church didn't mean anything to those people. But the fact that I rode a motorcycle, even if it wasn't a Harley, that meant that I understood something about them and they would open their lives and their hearts to me. You see, Paul's principle of becoming, I had come to understand what that meant. Those people needed for me to become something in order that they might give me a hearing and share the gospel to them. You understand that principle? Let's take one that's a little bit more familiar. I showed this picture last time when I was here. Because not far from this church, just up the road, is that's a hog. It's not a bear. It looks like a bear, but that's actually a hog. All 484 pounds of him. Boar. He's now proudly mounted on my wall in my office. Now, when I showed that picture last time, you know what happened? I automatically had affinity with some people and some families around here who do hog hunting. And there are people who go, you hunt hogs? And I said, oh, yeah. How do you kill them? Stab that puppy. You did what? Oh, yeah. Dogs caught him, stabbed him, put him out of his misery. Now he's in my freezer, 300 pounds of pork. You see, the fact that people that have never been to church, have never heard the gospel presented to them, if they're a hunter, if they're a woodsman, and I encounter them somewhere and they learn that I do this, you know what I have? I have a hearing with them that in God's good time, I become what I need to be in order they might hear the gospel and believe. So becoming as a personal principle, it's incarnational. Just as Jesus became flesh, I've become all things to all men that by what all possible means, I might win some. I don't want to be the first loser. And then finally, with the time we have left, becoming as a church principle. Now, let me go ahead and confess this on your behalf up front. Everybody in this room was good on the first principle. Becoming as a biblical principle, Jesus became flesh, the Word became flesh, that we might know Him. Amen. Hallelujah to that. We're glad for that. Amen. Right? I'm pretty good on that personal principle because I know that I know people that don't know Jesus. And they're not going to come to church here simply because I come to church here. But if I can have an affinity with them outside that recognizes their lives and what they do and what they like and spend time with them and build a relationship that shows that they're not a notch on a gun somewhere, but they're a person I'm interested in their soul and their salvation and their lives. I'm pretty good on that. But becoming as a church principal, this is where we bring the incarnation full circle, the Black Creek Baptist Church. Let me give you an image that how many of you can relate to this image right here? It's okay to say what this is in church. What is this? This is an outhouse. All right. Let's thin the crowd out a little bit. How many of you have never used one of these? Wow. You need to have that experience. You would never forget it. You'd never be the same. See, what many of you do not know, that those structures right there in American politics have played a big role historically. Because some of us grew up that was the facility. At home, that was the facility. Both my grandparents, they lived on a farm, and that was the facility. On one side, it was in the chicken yard. You had to fight the rooster to get to it. Thank God for Daisy BB guns. The other was just out back. A lot of politics in American history took place in a two-seater. Now, those of you who never used one of those can't imagine that, but yeah. I can remember schools, that was a facility. I can remember churches where that was the facility. If you went to church and it came time, use that facility. I show all that, number one, is because you will remember that as well. But when it comes to a church becoming, there was a day that served its place and its time and its role. It didn't preclude anybody coming to church because that's where you had to go. Are you glad that you don't have to do that anymore? Amen? Especially when it's 100 degrees outside and when it's 20 degrees outside. It served a purpose, but we moved on beyond that where we don't have to do that. This is an image taken from Cappadocia in Turkey. This is the part of the country. It was Asia Minor in the biblical times. This is where Paul did much of his missionary journey in modern-day Turkey. You see there in those rocky faces it's sandstone, it's limestone, where in those people dug through there and carved out houses and places and churches. That early on in the history of the Christian church, churches had to move in there to find a place to worship because it was illegal and you'd be killed if you were caught. And I got to visit one of these places there. You can't make it out, but there's a mural on that back wall inside. There's a city that was underground there. That this is where the church would gather and they would sit and they'd celebrate the Lord's Supper. That was the table they set out to celebrate the Lord's Supper. Underground. What did the church do? The church adapted from the first century to the 5th century and the 9th century to be the church, to be a becoming church. The church in Acts chapter 2 is not the church in Acts chapter 6 because we end up with deacons in Acts chapter 7 that we didn't have in Acts chapter 2. The church of Acts chapter 15 was not the church of Acts chapter 7 because the church of Acts chapter 15 was after Paul come back and said, listen, God wants Gentiles to be saved and a part of the church too. And they had a big business meeting back then. And the Spirit spoke and they heard. The church became what it needed to become in order that people might know the gospel. In 1993, we planted a church in Maryland. Started with about 30 people from another church. And this is where we met upstairs in a laundromat. Doesn't look like much of a church building, does it? 2,400 square feet upstairs. A metal door in front with no window, and a metal door in back, no window. You had to know where we were to find us in order to come. It doesn't look like a church, but we adapted. We became what we needed to become in that place that a church might be born. We outgrew the place, had to relocate, outgrew the place, had to relocate, on and on and on. You see, as a church, I understood that the church, there was a becoming principle for it as well. One of my favorite pictures in 2003, we'd ended up at the local high school, outgrown every other place that we could go to, and we maxed it at like 1,000 in attendance, and the school said, you got to have another place to meet. We're going to do maintenance, and there wasn't any place we could meet. So we moved outdoors for a season while we were doing renovations on a shopping center. We ended up staying out there 4 seasons. We went from a big crowd down to 120 people. And then winter set in, and the snow set in. And we used to set diesel torpedo heaters up under the side, blow up in there to warm it up so we could do church. This scene is taken, I think it was a January morning in 2003. It was 23 degrees outside. We had to shovel a snow path to get into the tent. You could set up 244 chairs and still have room for the worship team down front and for me to preach. The ground never thawed out. Your feet were always cold. But the place filled up. You know why? We became what we had to become in order to effectively do the gospel and reach people. You think it was church people that were showing up to do church in a tent when it's 23 degrees outside? Not on your life. It's people that heard God was doing something and that we were willing to color outside the lines to do it. Last picture, Todd saw this one on, I think, on my Facebook page. This is my concern, and this is my appeal to you. Because for you as a church in your future and what you do, are you a becoming church? Will you be a becoming church? Because a church that doesn't adapt itself culturally will end up being a church like this. This is actually a church not too many miles from here. Was out on a motorcycle riding one day, drove by, and there were, those were actually buzzards. They weren't turkeys out in the yard. Those are buzzards. There were a bunch of them perched up on the peak of the church, and there wasn't a place to stop, and so we went ahead and had lunch and went back, and I pulled over and stopped. I said, I got to get a picture of this. There are 40 buzzards that I could count in that picture right there. And I thought, is that a telling picture or what about a church that isn't the church that God wanted to be in the place and the time that God wanted to be that? A church where the buzzards gathered because that's where death is. So we're going to wrap up on this note. Two summary questions. Number one is, what kind of church has Black Creek been? In its 200 years history, I know it, at some periods of time, it's been a becoming church because it's gone through seasons and changes and adjustments and adaptations in its history to still be around. But in your lifetime, has this church been a becoming church? Or what kind of church has it been? And what kind of pastor does Black Church need to call in order to be an incarnational church? If the beginning of the gospel in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John, the coming of Jesus Christ is about incarnation and becoming, and you as a people say, we need to call, we're without a shepherd, we need a pastor, are you looking for a pastor that's going to lead you in being a becoming church in order to reach those there are to reach out here, because there are people everywhere in these woods, miles around, many of them have never heard Jesus Christ at all. Do you want to be the church that's the church that's going to reach those people because you're willing to be a becoming church in order to do that? Let me lead us in prayer. Father, Lord, I know these aren't easy words or ideas for these dear people. You alone know what's behind them, and you alone know what's before them. And it's my heart's desire, Lord, that they hear these words. That as they celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ, they're celebrating the fact that you became flesh in order that we might behold your glory and encounter you and be forgiven and know life eternal. And that you in turn then invite us as believers to become bridge builders by becoming to the people around us so that we might win the more. And you call us into a gathering of saints called a church in order that that gathering of saints doesn't get petrified in who they are and where they are and what they do and how they do, but they follow the leading of the Spirit in becoming something new and fresh with each new generation to reach a new generation of people that do not know you. So, Father, I commend them to you in this time of commitment and decision. Cause us to know what your will is for us. And we thank you for your love and your grace that makes it possible right now. It's in Jesus' name we pray and for his sake. Amen.